Okay, thanks a lot, Pancho, and thanks a lot for the organization for having me here. It's always a pleasure to be at CIMMYT, and I think it's about 20 years ago since I was here for the first time. That means two things, that CIMMYT is doing really well, and that I'm getting a little bit older. Okay, so you see the title. Yesterday I was in a workshop on synthesis of statistical crop growth modeling and other types of approaches, using, well, all kinds of techniques. And having been there for a whole day, I decided to change my talk a little bit, so there will be some basic stuff in it as well. Well, first, in principle, what we try to do is we try to predict our phenotype from information coming from the genotype and the environment. And the basic idea is that, well, the phenotype is a product of the interactions between genes, all kinds of products from those genes, and environmental stimuli. And of course, the major way in which plant breeding has tried to do that, let me see, does this work? Is this visible at both ends? Yeah. So on the top of the slide, you see that, well, if plant breeders are interested in an interesting piece of DNA, they try to make a cross and get that into the offspring. But then if they do that, there's a lot of DNA that actually they didn't want to be there. And so the promise of molecular biology, and now again of gene editing, is that you can just cut out the piece of DNA you want and put it in the background that is your favorite, and then everything will work again. And well, for me this looks a little bit like Lego, and you can do a lot with Lego, you can build a whole world of Lego, but I'm not yet convinced that it will work well here. So here's an alternative, and I think for this read the paper by Mark Cooper of a few years ago that describes how things are being done at Pioneer. And at Pioneer, I say they use, I think, the full chain from DNA up to the phenotype with all intermediate levels that you can think of, RNA, metabolites, proteins, but basically a lot of quantitative biology, a lot of quantitative genetics, a lot of Bayesian technology, mixed model technology, etc. Now, here, and let's say also over the last few days at these workshops, there's a lot of crop growth modeling going on. Now, a crop growth model is not so easy to summarize, and you see here a number of schedules that look quite impressive. In principle, there are a number of modules that take care of certain physiological functions. These interact with each other. And then at the end, you hope that there is emergent behavior that, well, relates to what happens in nature and in the field. And the idea of all of this is that our major problem is the genotype-environment interaction problem. And at the right, you see a few examples. At the top here, we have an example in which on the left and the right, let's say we have environments on the left, let's say poor environments, on the right, good environments. There are three genotypes. And when the environmental quality changes from left to right, we see that the phenotype doesn't change that much, actually not at all for those three genotypes. They keep the same difference wherever you are on this environmental gradient. Well, that is an easy situation because wherever we're going to do the phenotyping, we will be predictive for any other situation. Here to the right, we see that yes, when the environment improves, also the phenotypes improve, but they do so in the same way for all genotypes, so no interaction, but yes, there is plasticity. When we look at the other four situations, we see that these reaction norms, as we call them, let's say the functions that describe how a genotype translates the environment into a phenotype, these reaction norms, they diverge, converge, and that's, let's say, still with, well, retaining the same ranks across all environments. That's still not such a very difficult situation. The real issues appear down at this slide, where we see that the reaction norms start to intersect, and so evaluation in one type of environment will not be predictive of another type of environment, and we need models to help us, let's say, bridging the, well, this gap from one poor environment to a good environment or the other way around. And when we think of the genotypes in relation to genotype-environment interaction, we think of phenomena like adaptiveness, how well is a genotype doing a particular condition. We think of adaptability, how well does a genotype adapt itself, how sensitive is it to changes in the environment. Stability is another issue that's related to this. I won't explain that here. For the environments, of course, what we need to know is, well, what actually is it in the environment that drives those differences between the reaction norms that represent the genotypes? And then a major question is, these environments that I'm looking at, are they a representative sample of our so-called target population of environments, let's say the environments in which I want to grow my genotypes in the future? And of course, we're never completely sure that we're looking at the right target population of environments. And neither are we sure that in this limited set of trials that we have at our disposal, we are representing this target population of environments in the right way. Okay, so to help us in, let's say, predicting from the set of environments in which we do our trials or experiments to all of those growing environments in which we might be interested, we have so-called genotype to phenotype models. And there are various ways of, let's say, defining those models. We've seen a few examples already on the earlier slides. Now, in essence, I've written on this slide what I think that a good genotype to phenotype model should be doing. In a sense, it models the phenotype as a function of the DNA at the lowest level, and the DNA can be genes, but it can also be QTL effects. Typically, we think of the additive effects of alleles within a gene, but we can also think of interactions between the alleles, and we talk about dominance, of course, of importance in the question of heterosis. We can think of interactions between alleles, or let's say between alleles in different genes and QTLs, then we're talking about epistasis. We can also have interactions between traits, and this is an area that's opening up. We can measure more and more on our genotypes, and it's not very realistic to take all those traits together and model them at the same level, and you will see a number of examples what I mean with that later. So all these different types of traits that we measure, well, we try to put them in some kind of hierarchy that would help us in producing better predictions for the phenotype. And this is typically an area in which high-throughput phenotyping plays a role, because this extra information on the genotypes that is being collected in high-throughput phenotyping needs to find a way to produce better predictive models for the genotype by phenotype class. Okay, then of course we would also like to say something about the environmental factors that help us, well, predict what's going on in the different environments. And back to our major issue, the genotype by environment interaction. How do genetic factors, environmental factors interact with each other? And finally, in a way, I already announced that, well, we take into account the hierarchy of the biology. So when we go up from the DNA to the final phenotype, there are a number of intermediate levels that we would like to represent in an efficient way. Now, I think it's very useful, and especially yesterday when I was in this workshop, I noticed that what is on this scheme is not so completely evident. I mean, in the end, of course, and especially now in the genomic prediction era, we want to predict for new genotypes, ones that we haven't tested in the field or on a phenotyping platform. For those new genotypes, we want to predict what they're going to do in all kinds of environments. And then either the environment can, let's say, pertain to a particular class, particular environmental class, found by crop growth modeling or whatever, but it might also be something new, between quotes. So we need our genotype to phenotype models to provide predictions for new environments and new genotypes. And that's the quadrant over here. And I don't know why, but I've been for many years to all kinds of conferences on breeding and physiology, and most people think that a statistical model is not able to do this, to predict to new genotypes and environments. And I hope that at the end of this talk, well, you might have some idea of why I think it is possible. Okay, so let's start then with statistics, because in the end, that is what I dedicate most of my time to. A well-known class of statistical genotype to phenotype models is the QTL mapping model, the type of QTL mapping model. And what we try to do there is, well, identify a number of QTL locations, estimate the effects of the QTLs, the allele substitution effects, and explain how much variance is covered by those QTLs. And also, we can, of course, also use a QTL model to predict a phenotype. If we know which QTLs are driving the phenotype, we could use those to predict the phenotype. On the other hand, if a QTL is large, we might dedicate our attention especially to that QTL to take care that it is present in the right allelic form in offspring. Now, over the last 10 years, let's say the paradigm has gradually shifted to prediction. And we have the genomic prediction models that are being used for genomic selection. These are not very different from the QTL mapping models. The only difference is that here, let's say, we don't select so much which marker will enter our prediction model and which one won't. In principle, we use all the markers that we have, and the weight will be either the same or slightly different, whereas in a QTL model, the weight will be either 1 when the QTL is in and 0 when the QTL is not in. And the models that we're looking at, well, are the models at the lower part of this slide, mixed models, GBLUB, penalized regression, Bayesian models, and also increasingly so graphical models that are able to cover, let's say, the hierarchy of different types of traits that we have. Okay, now physiology, because in the end, what we want to do is we will try to get to some kind of synthesis of these different approaches. In physiological models, when I have to write it down, I would think that at the bottom we have a number of genotype-dependent parameters that in principle don't change too much when we change the conditions. They're kind of constants. Of course, in reality, this is not never ever completely the case, but for most practical purposes, these parameters should not change too much. Then there is environmental input. Well, and that's the typical input from soil, meteorology, etc. And then we have a level of what we call integrative or intermediate traits, and those traits are produced over the growing season by integrating information coming from the physiological basic parameters and the environment, and also, let's say, they are cumulative over the growing season for a particular type of intermediate traits like biomass. And those intermediate traits actually very often also show genotype by environment interaction. They're not completely free of environmental influences. And then finally, we have the target traits, which typically are yields or a few yield components. These are the things at the end of the growing season we want to predict. And we use the hierarchy below, the physiological parameters and the integrative intermediate traits plus the environmental inputs to get to those predictions. So if I try to formalize that, I could write it in this way, and I know that, well, it's probably still not fantastic, but to some extent it tries to make things, simple things, complicated. So there is a response, Y, for a genotype I in an environment J. I is always the genotype, J the environment, and this F is from the focal or target trait. And we get, let's say, to this final result by integrating all information over physiological and physiological traits that don't change with the environment, then intermediate traits or component traits that might change, and then there is Z, the environmental input. And what I just explained already, also for those component traits that are intermediate, and we do assume that there is environmental and physiological information that is underlying it. Also, these intermediate traits are kind of integration. So this is a formal way of writing it down, and that is useful later on when we go to our statistical model, because then we can borrow from this notation to see the similarities between the two types of models. So one way of thinking of the synthesis, and this is a kind of synthesis that was already alluded to by Martin Kropf himself in work with Paul Struik and Xinyu Yin, but also, let's say, a number of other groups have worked on this. In Australia, Mark has worked on it, Graham Hammer. In a sense, if you take the original crop growth model with its physiological parameters and its intermediate traits, and you replace the observations, the phenotypic observations on those traits by predictions from either a QTL model or a genomic prediction model, and you have a kind of integration of statistical approaches, statistical genetic approaches, and crop growth modeling. And what you hope is that by focusing on the more elementary, basic traits, you can get to quite good predictions based on a marker profile, and that by the integrative functions that are, let's say, proper to the crop growth model, the basic traits are translated into something complex like yield. So that is the idea of the synthesis. Now, if we go to the statistical models, the models we think of is, well, we have the simple models like linear models, mixed models for the single traits and environments, but actually we'll soon see that we always look at multiple traits and multiple environments to do our predictions and QTL mapping. We generalize increasingly so to so-called graphical models, and that is mainly because these graphical models are closer to crop growth models. They have a hierarchy of the different phenotypes and intermediate phenotypes. And the other thing is quite important, if we have a kind of network structure for our phenotypic traits, and we relate our QTLs to that network structure of phenotypic traits, we get a better assessment of what it means to change an allele in a particular QTL. In a network, evaluating the allelic substitution effect for a particular QTL is different from that, let's say, in all kinds of standard linear and mixed models. Okay, a simple genotype to phenotype model that was used for a long time. This, let's say, multiple trials. Genotype I, environment J, and let's say the replicates inside the environment J is called K. And the only thing that we have to see here is that there is a genetic main effect. We don't look at G by E. So this genetic main effect, GI, is the thing that we try to estimate from our trials, and that's the thing that we're going to use to base our selections on. Now, If we want to elaborate on that model, we might try to replace the estimate for the genetic effect by, let's say, a regression on markers. And if we have a QTL effect, well, if we have QTLs, we do that for a limited set of markers that are clearly related to the phenotype. If we have a genomic prediction model at the lower part of the slides, we don't care. We take all the markers that we have and we try to produce the accuracy as high as possible using the totality of the markers. Okay, now other types of models for this two-way situation. Here you have a number of classical analysis of variance models. We can use the terms either fixed or random, and I know this is always a bit complicated. I think for a fixed term we can say that in principle we would be able to know what is going on for that term. If we know that, let's say, the relative water availability is shaping the genotype by environment interaction, we could try to model sensitivity of genotypes to that water availability. That would be a fixed term in a regression model. If we don't know, then typically it becomes a random term, or if there are many genotypes, it's also better to take that sensitivity random. Now, if you walk down, let's say, this slide, you see that we get increasingly more complex models, and the model at the bottom is a model in which we have an intercept term mu ij that is nothing else than the prediction for genotype I in environment j by factors that we, in principle, can know. That might be a physiological model, a statistical model in which everything can be measured and known. Then the GIJ term is a residual of genetical effects of which we don't know very well what causes it. And then there is an environmental, and this epsilon at the end, well, that's plot error and all kinds of things that are not genetic. And at the bottom of the slide, there is a little bit complicated expression. And once again, all these formulae are just decoration. I mean, if you listen to me, then you won't have to look at the slide at all. But if you get bored with what I say, you can look at the slide. So what I try to express here is that it's important for those genetic variances and correlations that we try to get a good idea of what they represent. And typically what we do nowadays is for this random effect GIJ genetical effects, that we try to structure them by, on the one hand, information on the correlation between the genotypes, that is the sigma G, and on the other hand, we try to structure that relationship between the residual genetic effects by information on the environment. And for the genotypes, typically we use pedigree information or marker information. For the environments, we use all kinds of things about which I'm going to say something later. Now, in principle, a lot of statistics is geared at trying to describe the genotype-environment interaction. Now, on this slide, you see a number of models that I won't go into detail about. I think many of you will know these models. And if you look at their structure, you see that all of them try to describe the genotype-environment interaction as a kind of regression in which the genotype has a sensitivity to some kind of environmental descriptor. And this environmental descriptor can either be something that has been measured or been created by crop growth model or whatever, or it's something that is extracted from the data in the statistical analysis. And in that case, you have to find out what the statistical optimality criterion has produced for you. Can you understand why a particular environmental characterization causes the G by E? Okay, that is for the fixed part in principle that we could understand. For the part that we don't understand, we have to go back to our variances. And there are a few options. We can have a number of trials in which the genetic variance can differ strongly between the trials. This typically happens when we have, let's say, good yielding trials and badly yielding trials. So then there's heterogeneity of variance. If the situation is that most of the trials are very similar for the conditions, then we can use a simpler model. We could say, well, we have homogeneous genetic variance. The genetic variance is always the same. The same we can do for the correlations. If two trials are very similar, we expect that a lot of them, let's say a lot of the genetic basis is shared between those two environments, then we have a high genetic correlation. If two trials are very dissimilar, well, the genetic correlation will be low. So depending on the heterogeneity of your trials and also on your genotypes, you will need a more or less complex model, let's say, for this background genetic variation. This background genetic variation is essential for the detection of your QTLs. Everything that you want to do in terms of deciding whether the G by E that you think you can know is there or not depends on the structure you want to assume for the part you cannot describe so easily. Now, this is the most complicated slide, so if you're still with me, then I think you will survive also for the rest of the talk. What you see here is let's say the basic model that I myself, but also Pancho, Juan Burgueño, and quite a number of people are using for genomic prediction and QTL mapping. Also, it doesn't matter whether it's GWAS, QTL mapping, etc., and it doesn't matter whether it's QTL mapping or genomic prediction or a combination of both. We have the response genotype I in environment J. We have an intercept mu J that is nothing else than the environmental mean. Then there is a term here that contains the QTLs. And this X, well, is just representing the marker information. And typically the marker information can, well, be in terms of 0, 1, or 2 copies coming from a particular parent. And this alpha is then the allele substitution effect for the QTL. And you see that this alpha depends on the environment. And this means that for each environment, we allow the QTL effect to be different. We could also do it for multiple traits. We could have that we have multiple traits simultaneously mapped, and for each QTL, for each trait, we allow the QTL to be there or not, and when it's there to be different. So this is a fixed part of the model, because for the QTLs, we assume that in principle we can know them. Here is the random part, genetic main effects, plus interaction together. And this, let's say, is a model, well, that would take care of both QTL mapping and prediction, because for the residual genetic effect here, we could structure the variation by using the pedigree information, or let's say marker information coming from the marker profile. So this is a very powerful model that can be used in very many different contexts. Now, well, I was not completely honest, because I see this is more complicated than the former one. And I see that after this is an even more complex one. But the basic blocks stay the same. I mean, all of those formally I showed all have the same structure. So the only thing I've done here is I've split up the QTLs in two parts. You see there is something that is indexed by C and something that's indexed by Q. Well, this is mainly to indicate that if we have a number of known candidate genes, there is no reason why we would not include those immediately in our model. And we can still test whether they are there or not. And then for the rest, we can still try to find QTLs on top of those, let's say, candidate genes. For the residual genetic effects, we might have reasons to suspect that there are two types of residual genetic effects based on where you are in the genome. And those two different types of genetic effects could be structured in different ways and could also have different variances. So it's a very simple way of extending the model. Here is another way in which we extend the model quite often. It might be the case that if we see that the QTL effect depends on the environment, that we try to figure out what environmental variable is driving those allelic differences, or let's say the differences of the QTL allele from one environment to the next. So this term over here is nothing else than a regression on the environmental characterization Z. And we simply take the QTL allelic effects. Is my time over already? You're kidding. I'm still in my introduction. Okay, but let's say this Z is an environmental characterization that we can include in our model, and that helps us to understand our genotype. Well, I skipped this one. Okay, so this is, I think, the most important slide, because here we have the model that we saw before. So what is it that we try to do when we model G by E? Well, on the one hand, we try to find out what kind of environmental characterizations are driving the genetic differences, and here are sensitivities for the genotypes, and there is residual effects that we try to model, well, by structuring the genotypes in environments. And in red, where does our high-throughput phenotyping and high-throughput genotyping information come in? Well, in principle, they can be either used in the fixed part, so if I have high-throughput phenotyping information on my genotypes, I can include them here as this A, and I can estimate what is happening in the environments with respect to my genetic characterization that I found on the phenotyping platform. If it's not so clear, I can use the same information to structure the residual genetic effects. Okay, so if Pancho is right, I have to make up my mind now. Okay. Well, let's say what you see on this slide is more or less of what I said before. The only thing that so far you haven't seen is that we have this hierarchy in our modeling, because everything we do in a regression model means that all of the predictors are at the same level. So I think it's good to realize that if you look at the correlation between traits, then actually you can also think of it in terms of a network. And the only thing you have to do is you take this correlation matrix and you take the inverse of it, which is, let's say, well, if you multiply the correlation matrix with its inverse, you get the identity, so it's like dividing in normal arithmetic. Well, the good thing of the inverse correlation matrix is that it gives you a structure for the network. And this is quite important, because if we can use the structure of a network, we can use it to more effectively, let's say, model the QTLs. And by doing that, it allows us to say whether a QTL works directly on yield or whether it works on yield using an intermediate variable or intermediate trait, a trait that in principle can be measured in a phenotyping platform. And the talk of Daniela Bustos-Kortz at the end, because that's the trick, of course, I have only 5 seconds left, but at the end of this session there are another 15 minutes, in which this will be, what you see in yellow will be explained in detail later on. And from this point on, I had illustrations, but time's up. But okay, this was, yeah, so you don't see the illustrations. If you want the illustrations, I think you have to download the papers. But the story is actually this. I think you allow me to go to the conclusions.
Yeah, sure.
Oh, you also allow me to do the example. Let me. So, yeah. Okay, so if I go to the conclusions, now. So, for the genotype to phenotype models, you've seen how we can synthesize both the statistical approach and the physiological approach. Now, from the biology, what we use actually are crop growth models, systems biology models, let's say these layered models going from the DNA up to the final phenotype. For the statistical models, we have the multi-trait models, we have pen-life regression that I didn't explain. Graphical models is nothing else, let's say, than hierarchical models in which the phenotypes are structured in a particular hierarchy. Some recommendations with respect to the phenotyping. I think the basic thing always to do is, before you start to do any kind of modeling, take care that you remove the local and global trends in the field, in your phenotyping platform, whatever. There are a number of spatial methods around that do this. We came up with a new spatial method that fits a kind of surface across your field, and then the residuals from that surface actually are your genetic effects. Another thing that I didn't talk about, and I didn't intend to talk about either, but I mean, it makes an enormous difference which genotypes you're going to phenotype. So the choice of genetic population, GWAS panel, whatever, makes an enormous difference on whether you can see a particular phenotypic difference or not. Another thing about which Francois will talk surely is which environmental conditions to use, let's say, to do your phenotyping. And, well, this other thing about the hierarchy that I don't need to cover again, because these intermediate traits that might help you to do genomic prediction will be covered later on. And I think this is it. Yes, thanks. Okay. Now 5 minutes left, isn't it?
Yeah.
Why didn't I do the illustrations in those 5 minutes?
One question for Fred.
Fred.
Fred. Fred. Fred.
Yeah, Greg.
The microphone doesn't seem to be working, right? So
Chris, not all the maths again. We said that we've heard GWAS, we've heard structured, unstructured correlations for the patient today. Do you want to make some comment around the health, particularly around the capacity, given if we're targeting complex traits? Among the different diseases designed for the year, are there your own experience?
You mean for the kind of genetic population you want to include?
Well, there's this range of them.
Yeah, I know.
Everyone has their favorite. GWAS is giving a lot of useful information.
Yes.
And I just don't worry about GWAS and how much GWAS.
Well, I don't think, I mean, yes, you're right. I think GWAS panels are quite problematic in the sense that it's quite often unclear whether the corrections that you use to get away from your population structure is not also eliminating adaptive traits. That's definitely true. I mean, I have to say that GWAS panels are not my favorite. If you use one, I think you need to use one that consists of a number of clearly defined subpopulations, in which each of these subpopulations has, well, a clearly defined adaptational structure, and in which each of these subpopulations has about at least 50 genotypes so that you can do something inside those populations. Having said that, it's clear that if you have multi-parental populations, in which you can also generate a number of subpopulations from parents from which you understand how they are contrasting, I think those kinds of panels are far more powerful and insightful than the GWAS panels. I think especially one of the things that I don't like so much about GWAS panels, they often contain land races that are completely different from modern varieties, and then most of your analysis is driven by something that everyone immediately understands, but what is happening inside those land races and inside the modern varieties is very difficult to discern. And in that sense, I think use a homogeneous GWAS panel or use a multi-parental population.
All right, thank you very much, Fred.
Still fine for 25 minutes.